VIU Online presents GEC 101 English Composition, Week 1, Theoretical Lecture, Part 1, Expectations for College Writing, and Critical Thinking and Argument. This lecture is presented by Dr. Laura Hills, Professor of English at Virginia International University. You are taking this course because your college instructors and your future colleagues and supervisors will expect you to demonstrate many abilities. These include the ability to think critically, to consider ethical issues, to find and solve problems, to conduct effective research, to work productively with other people of widely different backgrounds, and to present the knowledge you construct in a variety of ways and in a variety of genres and media. So, is GEC 101 a course about writing, or is it a course about thinking? I have been a professional writer for a little more than 30 years. I have written 5 books and published hundreds of articles. And I can tell you from that experience that writing and thinking are inextricably linked. Of course, you cannot write if you don't think. But what I have found throughout the course of my career and as a professor teaching students to write, that when we become a better writer, we also become a better thinker. When we write, we're taking our reader on a journey, and that requires us to put ourselves outside of our own thought and into the head of the reader. We become teachers and tour guides, storytellers, entertainers, and we have to figure out, as though we're solving a puzzle, how best to present our ideas so that the reader will not only understand them, but be engaged in what we're saying. So, for my money, I would say that if one wants to become a better thinker, there's probably no better way to do it than to write. So, GEC 101 is a writing course, but it is one in which you will develop your critical thinking skills this term. You will need to move beyond the skills you've developed as an informal writer, such as the skills you use in social media, and sharpen your skills as an academic writer. Now, I'm very active on Twitter. I tweet every day, and I'm also very active on Facebook, and I can tell you that the kinds of writing I do in social media are quite different from the kinds that I do in academic writing. I believe that being active in social media has made me a more fluid writer, as I've seen in my students as well. But there are conventions used in academic writing that we would not use in social media. And we will be highlighting those differences throughout this course. You've got to be able to analyze and interpret the work of others, and eventually, you've got to be able to create new knowledge based upon your own thinking and on what others have said. That is the difference between academic writing and perhaps much of the writing that you've done prior to this course. You may have given reports, and reports are fine. They're very useful. It's a good skill to have. But you're about to make the leap into academic writing. And when you are an academic writer, in many instances, you must go beyond simply reporting, but adding your own interpretations and ideas. And that is where we're going to focus a lot of our effort in the writing assignments that you will tackle this term, in the creation of your own ideas and supporting them through careful research and argumentation. We are considering this week many ways to make our writing more direct. We're urged to get to the main point quickly, to provide definitions, to state our main point early, to avoid digressions, and to, in other ways, make our writing easy for academic audiences to consume. If I invited you to my home for dinner, I might prepare a dish such as this one, spaghetti and meatballs, but certainly I would not pull out pasta uncooked and serve it to you that way, or raw meat. I must prepare the food so that you can consume it easily and want to. The same is true in writing. We don't provide raw writing. We have to cook it and make it a delectable dish for our readers. We are also urged to become engaged readers. Your instructors will expect you to be able to interact with the text. Now, you've been reading for a very long time, but what we're asking you to do in academic reading may be a little different than the reading you have done before. When you're an active reader, you are questioning, you are thinking about the process, you are finding points of agreement and disagreement. And so it's not a passive activity. You are thoroughly in it with the author, as though you are having a conversation with that author. And that's the kind of reading we're going to focus on this term and throughout the rest of your academic courses. Readers depend upon writers to organize and present their material. This calls to mind an expression that can guide you in your writing. If the writer doesn't suffer, the reader will. As writers, we must have our readers in mind as we choose every word, phrase, and sentence, because if you don't, you end up with a reader like this one, confused and probably on the verge of a headache. Now, does the writer truly have to suffer? Not always. Sometimes the writing flows and I find personally that I can get into it and I'm having a fine time. But there are times that I can be honest, you will be having to do some writing that maybe you'd rather not do. Another revision, another pass through the text. But if you don't do that and you present half-cooked writing, this is the result you will achieve in your reader. The writer must consider the rhetorical situation. That includes the writer, audience, context, time and space limitations, medium and genre, tone and style, and level of language. So, thinking about it, think of a beautiful landscape. Notice how everything here works harmoniously: sky and mountain, trees and water. When everything is in balance and it comes together, it's as beautiful as this picture is. In academic writing, you've also got to understand the assignment you've been given by your instructor. One of the most common questions students will ask me is, how long is my paper supposed to be? And I always say the same thing, as long as a piece of string. That's my funny way of saying that you've got to fulfill the assignment. So make sure you understand what is that piece of string your instructor is expecting from you, and make yours the right length and type. Choosing a topic when your instructor asks you to do that is a crucial step in academic writing. It's recommended that you choose a topic that truly interests you and that you know your rhetorical stance, your stand on the topic. And you've got to know your purpose as a writer. It's as though there's a door that's locked, and when you get all of those questions answered, you choose the right key and the door opens easily. If you don't know all those things, the door will remain locked. No matter which other keys you try, it will be hard to open it. Get all of that in front of you, figured out, and then it's very easy to write the paper. When we write, we must keep a specific audience in mind. Your instructor and classmates will be your audience for this course. But you must also consider the broader audience who you may be trying to reach through your writing. Think big. A large group. Who are the people you are writing for? And speak to them as though they are really going to read your paper. We must also consider the genre in which we're writing. You may also be asked to write using different media. When I took English composition as an undergraduate student in the 1970s, there was no internet, there was no web, And so English composition at that time had no component about writing for electronic media. You will see in this course that there is a module in which we discuss that at some length, because in truth, you will be writing for electronic forums, whether it be in your academic work or certainly in your work life. Most of your academic writing will be done in standard academic English, and a great deal of it will be done in formal style. And that's because that's the language of the academy. It's not a value judgment. It's just to prepare you for the kind of discourse that you're expected to enter into as a university student. Before writing, you are encouraged to explore your topic. You can brainstorm, free write, cluster and mind map, draw or make word pictures, keep a journal, consult numerous sources, collaborate or ask questions to immerse yourself in your topic. And one of the projects you're going to undertake in this course is a clustering map or mind map. This is just one of a many bag of trick tools that you will have to help you get started on a research project. The key then is to narrow your topic, and your goal is to draft a working thesis. In many ways, the writer in the beginning stages of the project is a detective, trying to figure out what it is that he or she is going to write about, what argument to make, and what sources to use. There are many ways to organize your information, spatially, chronologically, or logically, for example. Information organized logically can illustrate, define, classify, compare and contrast, show cause and effect, present a problem and solution, narrate, or create an analogy. There are many choices, and one of the most important pieces of advice you will gain from this course is that before writing, there are these choices to be made, and making the right choice will make the writing much easier. A storyboard can help you come up with an organizational plan. Storyboards can be created with cards or sticky notes like this one. In fact, I know a professional writer, a playwright, who creates storyboards for each of her plays, very much like this one. This is, again, a tool to add to your bag of tricks as a writer. This concludes the Part 1 section of the theoretical lecture for Week 1. Please continue with Week 1, Theoretical Lecture, Part 2.